It's 10 p.m. in Banjul, and from our studios on MDI Road, this is the News Force, the headlines. President Jammeh hosts an Islamic conference in his home village in commemoration of the Gambia's 51st independence anniversary. Anticipation heightens in Kiang as residents eagerly look forward to the completion of the 50-kilometer Karantaba-Sankandi Road. Ugandan President Yoweri Museveni takes an early lead in the presidential election against the backdrop of allegations of ballot stuffing emanating his closest opponent, Dr. Kizza Besigye. And Virgin Galactic prepares to take another bold attempt to take scientists and innovators to space after its first attempt ended in tragedy. Well, viewers, those are your headlines with me, Winifred Nicole. Thanks for joining us once again. The President, His Excellency Sheikh Professor Alhaji Dr. Yahya A.J.J. Jammeh Babili Mansa, hosted an Islamic conference in his home village on Thursday night to commemorate the 51st anniversary of the Gambia's attainment of independence. The event drew a cross-section of Muslim community and some notable Muslim scholars and preachers who delve into various topics affecting society. Details will come in our subsequent news bulletins. Still on matters of the soul, as we commemorate the 51st anniversary of the attainment of nationhood, Christians recently gathered at Gambia Christian Council grounds to pray for the nation and its leaders. Ibrahim Ajalo was there for GRTS and he now reports.
Prayer is a key ingredient and perhaps the only reliable step one could take toward instilling peace, progress, and prosperity in any nation. Cognizant of this fact, the Christian community in the Gambia recently gathered to observe prayers dedicated to the nation and its leaders. Christian leaders, including the national president, Pastor Dr. John Gomez, Professor Augustine Bernard, Bishop-elect, the Chief Justice of the Gambia, Emmanuel Fagwenle, among other Christian faithful, who constitute the Christian non-denominational and charitable fellowship, fulfilled their yearly prayer mandate to the nation.
Yes, we gained independence in 1965. But true independence, national identity, dignity, pride, and democracy was ushered in this country in 1994 when those gallant soldiers took it upon themselves to change the course of history of the nation under the dynamic leadership of His Excellency, Chair Professor Alhaji Dr. Yahya A.A. Jammeh Babili Mansa, President and Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces of the Republic of the Gambia. Today marks the 13th year of the establishment of the prayers for the nation and leaders and the Pastoral Fellowship International. And our 35th edition, praying for the nation and leaders. And you in particular with joy and your support.
The prayer, which covered all aspects of national and human development, was presided over by various Christian leaders.
Father, I thank you this evening for your grace upon our lives, for your mighty hand upon our lives, for your deliverance, and Lord, for everything that you have done for us. I pray that this program, Lord, will go according to your plan, and that at the end of this program, Lord, you will hearken unto our prayers, and the Gambia, Lord, will continue to experience peace, prosperity, development, and divine health in the name of Jesus.
And we want to stand in the gap for the nation. Jerusalem today is our Gambia. Gambia is our Jerusalem. And the scripture is urging you and I that we should believe in God so that we will be established in this land and that we should believe his prophets. So the nation is urged to believe the servants of God who are standing in the gap daily to pray for the nation. It is on this note that we will continue in our prayer for the nation.
In an interview with GRTS, the national president dilated on the significance of prayers while preaching religious tolerance and national security. Ibrahim Ajalo, GRTS News.
Still on the theme of independence, a documentary detailing the significant role played by the unionist, journalist, and activist Edward Francis Small in the struggle for independence, premiered recently at Ebunjang Theatre. Credit for the educative production goes to University of the Gambia professor Pierre Gomez and team. Kumbaba tells us more.
Edward Francis Small, Voice of Conscience, is the title of this documentary recently launched by Professor Gomez and his team. The film focuses on the role played by Edward Francis Small in various areas of education, trade, unionism, among other activities, both at home and abroad. This video launching, which coincided with the independence of the Gambia, is expected to enlighten people about the history of the country. At the same time, dig deep into the story of the main character, the trade unionist and the politician, Edward Francis Small.
I have the pleasure of reviewing this evening seeks to unveil the truth about a hitherto distorted aspect of the history of Gambian nationalism. It focuses on the indelible role of Edward Francis Small.
The Director of Research of the Ministry of Higher Education has funds set aside for all who wish to do substantive research, such as this that we are arranging today. A portion of these funds were used to partially finance this very great piece of work that Professor Gomez and team has just accomplished.
According to P.S. Barry, research is a central theme in his ministry's development endeavor. He challenged Gambians to venture into research to regain the country's cultural value and political diversity. For Professor Gomez, the video seeks to unveil the truth of the Gambia, particularly its colonial past.
The organic intellectuals we believe we are, we refuse to confine ourselves in the ivory towers of the university to serve our selfish ends. Yes, we have three important mandates: to teach, to conduct research, and community service. It would have been very easy to just do one of them, that is to teach, from the classroom to our house. And that's it. End of month, we receive our salary. We do the normal way.
Mohamed Lamine Touré, alumni of the University of the Gambia, was involved in the production of the documentary.
I will always offer my services to the university for the production of such documentaries that will continue to enlighten our people. It is said for a very long time that our history has been written and narrated by others other than ourselves, and it's time now we tell our own history using all available means at our disposal.
The documentary is a new collection in the Gambia's emerging literary field and a fair reading of the founding fathers of the Gambia's independent struggle. For GRTS News, I am Kumbaba.
Commuters traveling along the famous Kariba Avenue would notice the impressive display of the Gambia's four colors on the sides of the main thoroughfare and on the premises of some business premises whose owners are equally celebrating the Gambia's attainment of independence. GRTS's Ibrahim Ajalo was out and about, and he now files us in.
The Gambia generally takes the form of traditional march past, involving school children, security services, and voluntary organizations. However, this day resonates very well with the people of the Gambia. Just take a walk about on the country's main square and the busiest avenues, and the feel of nationalism everywhere. The national flag has adorned most of the landmarks and business centers of the Kariba Avenue, including this eatery. The owners of Max Caesar's restaurant have a special way of celebrating the country's 51st independence. These carefully choreographed decorations with painting depicting the colors of the national flag are therefore not only to beautify the front of the restaurant. The idea, according to the proprietor and staff, is exclusively designed to celebrate the country's independence.
We live here for 15 years. Then nobody can deny that Gambia is the most peaceful country in the world. So that's why we want to show everybody that Gambia is deco peaceful.
The Gambia is a peaceful country, and that its independence deserves maximum respect from all residents of the country, regardless of nationality, Salam added. GRTS further gave the opinions of the staff of the famous restaurant on the significance of the days.
Normally, Mark Caesars, we normally celebrate the independence as usual. Last year was, you know, amazing. Last year we have a big flag of the national flag. Then that one was surrounded with the restaurant, and it was really amazing. Then from there too, we used to make things like cake, all that thing to celebrate the independence of the Gambia.
I'm very proud to be Gambian, and you see, Mark Caesars also are very proud because you see the Gambian flag. We are so happy.
As Gambians, we need to promote our own culture, our own destiny as Gambians, because we have been doing this thing. It's not the first or the second thing, is the third. So as we celebrate Gambian independence yesterday, so we try to paint our place to make sure we promote the Gambia in the next level.
It is the same story for the remaining area of the main avenue, with the Barton Harding Highway sporting flags, which have been hoisted to mark the National Day. It is that sort of nationalism that is so evident on a day the countries reflect on her past, and of course, moment to chart a way for its future prosperity. Ibrahima Diallo, GRTS News.
The Minister of Transport, Works and Infrastructure, Bala Garba Jahumpa, visited two ongoing road construction projects in the Lower and Upper River regions. HN Silva went along, and he reports the projects are expected to have a telling effect on the lives and livelihoods of people in the beneficiary regions and beyond.
This week-long nationwide tour was meant to sensitize APRT supporters about the party's preparation for the upcoming presidential elections and the ongoing supplementary voter registration exercise in his capacity as Secretary General of the ruling APRT party. Bala Garba Jahumpa was nonetheless able to visit major development projects under his purview by virtue of his position as Minister of Transport, Works, Infrastructure, and National Assembly Matters. The minister's first port of call was at the 6.5-kilometer-long Sotomasire-Gambisara Road, where work is at an advanced stage.
Gambians could recall that in one of the Meet the People store, the people of Gambisara appealed to the leader of this nation and the leader of our July 22nd revolution, His Excellency Sheikh Professor Dr. Alhaji Yahya Abdul Aziz James Junku Jame Babili Manta. And he promised the people of Gambisara that yes, he is going to do this road. And as vanguards of the July 22nd revolution, when a leader gives a directive, we act like a bifal. So this is why this Gambisara road project, the artwork has been finished, the structures have been finished, the surfacing has been finished.
Gambisara is a predominantly Sarahule settlement where business is the order of the day. The community is steadily growing in size, but has been grappling with the lack of roads, transport infrastructure to link it to other settlements in the region. During his visit to the bustling settlement sometime last year, President Jame laid out plans to build this road and tasked the transport minister and his team of technicians there and then to work out the necessary logistics for the project to kick off.
His Excellency President Yahya Jame Babili Manta, as a man of God, may God guide him through the path of righteousness in his name's sake. Your Excellency Sir President Yahya Jame Babili Manta, God will also make you lie down in green pastures, because when you lie down in green pastures, you know there is a meal there for him. Your Excellency Sir President Yahya Jame Babili Manta, God will also set a table before you in the midst of your enemies.
The road, when completed, is expected to serve as a source of income for the central government and the regional administration due to the increased vehicular traffic and trade, especially with towns and villages in the southern Senegalese region of Casamance.
As you can see, this road is just not meant for the people of Gambisara. You have seen this big truck that has just crossed us. All the goods that you have loaded is going outside Gambisara, that is going to Casamance, the Senegal, and up to Guinea-Bissau. So Gambisara is at a very
strategic location. So this road is very important and it has come at a very right time.
From the Sotomayor Gambisara Road in the Upper River region, the minister and delegation travel on the 50-kilometer Karantaba Sankandi Road in Kiang Lower River region for the same purpose. Like that of Gambisara, work is also nearing completion with workers applying the finishing touches.
In Kiang West, you have also seen the evidence. The Sankandi to Karantaba Road, the people of Kiang West have been suffering for 32 years under the so-called First Republic, which I refer to as the Bourgeois Republic. So as Gambians, the honorable thing for us to do is to continue to pray for the long life and good health of our leader, His Excellency President Yahya Jammeh Babili Mansa. And as vanguards of the July 22nd Revolution, we hope and we are confident, inshallah, that Allah will reward him.
Infrastructural developments like the two road projects have been one of the hallmarks of the July 22nd Revolution, which has ushered in several life-changing interventions over the past 21 years. Those and several others are some of the issues Gambians will consider when going to the polls in December this year. Something, Jahumpa said, will continue relentlessly.
The progress and the advancement and the development of this nation continues under the leadership of His Excellency, President Yahya Jammeh Babili Mansa, who is also the leader of our July 22nd Revolution. You have also seen the evidence in URR.
The Karantaba Sankandi project in particular is of great significance, taking into account the distance residents of the area need to travel before reaching the national highway and the wear and tear of vehicles plying the road, which essentially raises costs and reduces the area's attractiveness to commercial transportation. Echand Silva, GRTS.
That report by HN Silva takes us to a fourth break, but we will be back with news from outside the Gambia. Stay tuned. Welcome back. Voting in Uganda's presidential election has been extended into Friday, after ballot materials in a number of mainly opposition strongholds were said to have been delivered late. Preliminary results show incumbent president Yoweri Museveni heading for re-election. It would be his fifth term if elected. The main opposition candidate, Dr. Kizza Besigye, was briefly detained by police on Thursday near a government building where he claimed ballot stuffing was taking place. Details in this DWTV report.
Commission has been releasing results, provisional results, every 2 hours today, and it would appear that Museveni has taken an early lead, claiming over 60% of the votes cast so far, with Kizza Besigye, his key rival, coming in second with just over 30%. The other candidates sharing what is left, which is not much of the votes cast so far. But what is interesting is that even as the Electoral Commission is announcing results, there were people who are voting today. As you said, voting was postponed in some polling stations, and so those people went to cast their ballots with information of just who was in the lead.
And there's a fair bit of concern that these elections have not been fair and free so far. Had they been, would the outcome have been any different?
Some people believe so. I mean, we have reported time and again about the allegations of ballot stuffing. There have been concerns of police officials and personnel being used to do this. In fact, there was a scuffle in one of the polling stations when one of the police officers was nearly beaten by the locals because he allegedly brought a ballot box that was full of already ticked ballot boxes in favor of Museveni. But of course, these are allegations. As to whether or not Yoweri Museveni would still be in power if everything would go correctly, I guess no one will ever know.
And Edith, you have been reporting for us that there are people in the country who are desperate for change. Why has the opposition not been able to make a breakthrough briefly?
Because they're going against a government that has been in power for 30 years. So it means they have the state machinery behind them. They do also have loyalists, people who believe that change is not required in Uganda. But more than that, they're working against a divided opposition. So you have Kizza Besigye on one hand, Amama Mbabazi, who was the prime minister in Yoweri Museveni's party, but they don't have a similar message. So it divides their votes. And again, as I mentioned, going against a very powerful government. In that way, the electoral
Virgin Galactic is returning to space, raised after the deadly crash in 2014. Richard Branson is unveiling a new spaceship today. The six-seater plane is designed to take researchers and innovators into space. More in this DWTV report.
The spaceship that Virgin Galactic is set to unveil today. Test flights are scheduled to take off later this year. Nearly 700 affluent adventurers are hoping that everything goes smoothly because they've put down deposits of $250,000 each for a chance to fly into space on board this ship.
The unveiling of spaceship is a very important technical milestone on our path to recommencing flight test.
The first Virgin Galactic spaceship crashed 16 months ago during a test flight, killing one of the two pilots. After the accident, many industry experts expressed skepticism about Virgin Galactic's reliability. The new spaceship could help the company stage its comeback.
We've incorporated a lot of small changes which have, I think, made a significant overall difference to the vehicle. And as for the specific cause of the accident in back in October of 2014, we've actually addressed that specific area. So we now have a device in the new spaceship which will prevent that happening again.
Virgin Galactic isn't the only company hoping to fly tourists into space. Rivals include Tesla founder Elon Musk and his company SpaceX, as well as several others.
We take our second break now. Sports is next. Welcome back. Boarding athletes representing the Gambia's seven administrative regions have been battling for supremacy on the tracks at the Independence Stadium in Bakau. The inter-regional athletes for lower basic school pupils used to be a familiar feature of Independence Day activities. And from the look of things, one can safely say officials in charge are seeking to revive what was a comatose activity. Momodo S. Jalo has more on Thursday's Independence Day school sports in this report.
This is one of the main features of the Independence festivities. And for the first time in 4 years, the competition is back at its spiritual home, the Independence Stadium. Primary school sports enthusiasts from the six educational regions and dignitaries stormed the Independence Stadium in their large numbers to witness the regional athletics championship for lower basic schools. The annual athletic competition has been one of the main activities commemorating the Gambia's independence and the breeding ground for the country's next generation of athletes. The event provides the rare platform for lower basic school children from around the country to interact, showcase their athletics potentials, and have fun and feel the meaning of nationhood. Region 2 schools who have dominated this championship for the past 5 years so their unprecedented five consecutive victories finally come to an abrupt end, with Region 1 dethroning them. Yaya Toure made history by becoming the first athlete to win on the new tracks, finishing ahead of his rivals in a thrilling end to the 100 meters junior boys. But Region 1 recovered in a stunning fashion to win the subsequent events, with Binta Jallo at the forefront of their championship post. It was a two-horse race between the defending champions Region 2 and Region 1, but Region 3, 5, and 6 did pretty well in the open categories of the competition. The relay events brought the entire stadium to its collective feet with some very tight races. Again, Region 1 and 2 continued their fierce rivalry right to the death. Aside from those races, there were too the traditional light-hearted events like the three-legged race, lemon spoon, and potato race. They were some of the fun events which thrilled the crowd. The sack race produced one of the tightest finishes, which left young Momodes Jallo inconsolable after narrowly missing out on the first position when he fell just before crossing the finishing line. And after what was an eventful day that ended well into the night, Region 1 scored the highest points with 311 to be crowned champions, ending Region 2's reign, who have to settle for second position with 305 points. Region 3 scored 287 points in third position. Region 6 got 233 points, and Region 4 scored 228 points. Momodes Jallo, GRT Sports.
Let's now take a look at the weather report, courtesy of the Central Forecast Office.
The Gambia is endowed with a wonderful landscape full of baobab trees, like its key point in Bacau. It is one of the most exotic sceneries in the world. The baobab tree is a symbol of resilience, wisdom, and resourcefulness. For the baobab tree provides good food in times of hunger, rents its bark for medications, and its sap for glue. In the Gambia, there is a company like the baobab tree, 100% African and purely Gambian in all aspects. In know-how, design, value, capital, and management. That company is Elton. Elton, employing hundreds of Gambians and proudly associating itself with development in the Gambia. Elton, side by side with the Gambia.
Hello viewers, welcome to the weather forecast. We experience a warm and sunny atmosphere accompanied with hazy conditions during the period. Satellite picture indicates convective activities over southern Africa. These activities will lead to wind and thunderstorm over the affected areas. For tonight's focus, the weather is expected to be warm during the early hours of the night, becoming cool towards morning with persistent hazy conditions during the period. And for the day tomorrow, the weather is expected to remain hazy with a warm and sunny atmosphere in the afternoon. Surface winds will northeasterlies in orientation with a speed of 10 to 20 kilometers per hour, becoming occasionally gusty up to 32 kilometers. Morning temperatures will be 18 degrees over the greater Banjul area, 15 over west coast and lower river wilds, 14 degrees Celsius over north bank and central river region. Upper river will experience a temperature of 13 degrees Celsius. Afternoon temperatures will be 34 degrees over the greater Banjul area, rising to 36 degrees Celsius over west coast. 37 degrees Celsius will be experienced over north bank, lower river and upper river region, while 38 degrees Celsius will be experienced over central river region. Low tides will be 0.4 meter at 2:16 a.m. and 0.3 meter at 2:24 p.m. High tides will be 1.5 meters at 8 a.m. and 1.7 meters at 9 p.m. Wave height will be about 1 to 2 meters, slight northerly swells. The sun will rise at 7:27 in the morning and will set at 19:12. We thank you for watching and have a blessed evening.
And before we take leave of you, a recap of the day's main stories. President Jammeh has hosted an Islamic conference in his home village in commemoration of the Gambia's 51st independence anniversary. Anticipation has heightened in Kiang as residents eagerly look forward to the completion of the 50-kilometer Karangtaba Sankandi Road. Ugandan President Yoweri Museveni has taken an early lead in the presidential election against the backdrop of allegations of ballot stuffing emanating his closest opponent, Dr. Kizza Besigye. And Virgin Galactic is preparing to make another bold attempt to take scientists and innovators to space after its first attempt ended in tragedy. Well, viewers, that was all in this edition of the News at 10. From me, Winifred Nicole, and the entire news team, thanks for being there. Enjoy the rest of our programs.